This new series, When the Vow Breaks, will explore all the difficulties, the hardships, the ups and downs, the highs and lows, the conflict of marriage, even separation, even divorce and remarriage. It will uncover myths and lies that we have bought into as it relates to the issues that really go on in marriage, even Christian marriage. It will expose things that most of us hide away from or shy away from of being honest about that are really going on in marriages, may it be a Christian marriage or a non-Christian marriage. There are so many issues that we'll deal with that will consist of, but are not limited to, addictions, adultery, abuse, abandonment, habitual unrepentance of sin. When you have a spouse that's controlling or domineering, dealing with mental illness in marriage, anxiety disorder, depression, financial infidelity, dealing with a sexless marriage, dealing with a marriage that you feel disregarded, dealing with different parenting styles that has caused you both to not only feel like your partners anymore, but that you're only co-parenting. And because your parenting styles are so different, you all have chosen to not even be in a loving relationship anymore. But all you're focused on is just trying to make it through as just a family and not even worried about the marriage. It'll talk about addictions, dealing with alcohol, gambling, porn, sex, shopping addiction, social media addiction, someone that's a workaholic. You have a spouse that you feel neglected, you feel abandoned, you even feel abused, both physically, mentally, emotionally, financially. We will uncover the truths that people are going through so many different type of difficulties that they feel like they're the only one. They feel like no one else can understand their story. This series will let you know that you are not alone. I'll be interviewing several different people that have gone through just tremendous things in marriage, and some have stayed and some have decided to divorce. I'll even have a person I'm interviewing who has a spouse who's incarcerated. So how do you deal with that when the vow breaks and that person has broken the law and now they're incarcerated and you all are separated because of their bad decision making? And, you know, it affects the children, it affects the marriage, it affects the spouse and how they financially are having to take on all the responsibility of parenting. When your spouse changes into someone else, you know, the day you said I do at the wedding, you could never have imagined that that person would become someone that you didn't even recognize or someone that you can't even believe who they are anymore. You have lost even faith in who they are. We'll also uncover the things of money issues, financial infidelity. Will really define what it means when we say divorce is not an option, but what happens when divorce becomes an option? What happens when separation becomes part of the story of your marriage, where you feel like you're even either threatened physically or emotionally, or there's some type of abuse, or there's some else going on in the marriage that you feel like you literally need to separate from that person? Maybe an in-home separation where you are living separate from each other within the house, or that person actually has to leave the home. We're going to deal with mistrust, brokenness, dishonor, disrespected marriage, the hurt, the pain, childhood traumas, resentment, a lack of communication. We're going to deal with family and in-laws when sometimes you have a good marriage, but you didn't marry into a good family. We're going to deal with religious beliefs, belief systems, core values. We're going to deal with chronic disease, illness, and sickness. You know, a lot of times we make that vow in sickness and in health, but what happens when you marry someone and they become sick and your whole marriage has been in sickness and it has not been in health? We're going to deal with stress, pressure, tragedy, death, and loss of loved ones. May that be the death of a child or a parent, sick parents, when they have to come and stay with you, or you have to make the choice financially to start paying their bills or paying their medical expenses. What happens when that happens? What happens when the children leave home and you're looking at a stranger? When I was doing research for this particular series that will go on for quite some time, because we're going to cover so many issues, it's actually more so like a ministry when the vow breaks versus just a series. I was amazed at so many people that I've talked to or different articles that I read who are so fearful for their last child to graduate from high school because they feel, hey, we don't really have a marriage and I'm probably going to get a divorce. And I thought to myself, well, then there's a syndrome there called one child away from divorce. And, you know, and I have really met people in person who feel that way. Particularly more women have confessed this to me saying, you know, I don't feel like my spouse really loves me. I don't really love them. I don't feel like we have a marriage. All we've done is just, you know, parent these children. And when that last child leaves the house, I'm gone, you know. So again, we're going to deal with this new syndrome of one child away from divorce, where people are literally plotting and planning to not be married to their spouse once their last child leaves the home. We're going to deal with a lack of praying together, when there's a lack of spiritual leadership in the home, when there's a lack of commitment and communication. What does it really mean to say, hey, I vowed on that day unto death do us part, but what does that really look like? How do we really make it a whole lifetime? We're going to deal with the infertility when that happens in marriage and how that takes a toll on a husband and a wife, on your finances, on your emotional health, your mental health, even on the marriage. Some people have divorced over infertility. We're going to talk about blended family issues. We're going to talk about narcissism, manipulation, and personality disorders. We're going to talk about when you have a spouse who's lazy and has slothfulness. We're going to talk about the slow fades of marriage. You know, it doesn't happen overnight. You know, the different things and the complications that come out of marriage, it's not an overnight thing. It's gradual, but we're going to talk about how to recognize those slow fades before they happen. We're going to talk about sin, the different sin and the selfishness that go on in marriage. And that's why the vows are breaking. All these different issues is why our vows are breaking, why our marriages are breaking apart. We're going to talk about the things that you have thought that are unappealing anymore about your spouse. It could be anything from just how they talk to you to the way they look now, excessive weight gain, their lack of motivation, ambition. You know, everybody has their different definition of what they find to be beautiful, both spiritually and naturally. We're going to deal with those issues. We're going to deal with the issue of a lack of quality time and investing time into one another. We're going to really, really answer the question, how did we get here? How do you get from two people standing at the altar, you know, with just butterflies in their stomach, being so nervous in front of a group of people that they love and before God and before a minister, you know, vowing to spend the rest of their life together no matter what happens, and then you get to a place, this place of here and now, and wonder, why do I want to leave? Why do I just want to walk away? We're going to deal with anger in marriage. Why do we find ourselves being so angry and quickly angered by our spouse? We're going to deal with lies and deception that go on in marriage. We're going to deal with poor communication. We're going to deal with things as simple as people that are married to spouses who lack the ability to give an apology when they're wrong. They lack the ability to take ownership of when they've done something wrong. We're going to deal with when you're dealing with a spouse who is depressed. We're going to deal with the issue of, I know I can make it through my marriage, but do I have to be miserable and unhappy all the time? We're going to deal with unhappiness and misery in marriage. We're really going to uncover and unpack the ongoing battles of the same arguments that most people keep having year after year in their marriage. We're going to deal when love is the problem. You feel like you have, quote unquote, fallen out of love with them. And, you know, a lot of times marriage is like the tale of two cities. It's the worst of times and the best of times. We're going to teach how you make it through the good and the bad, and how you have to be able to make it seamless, where every stage of your marriage, you realize we're learning. Even if we're on a mountain or we're in a valley, it becomes seamless because we know we have a partner and that we're anchored in the Lord. But we're going to try to really hone in on making that relationship seamless, that you don't look at any other time as good or bad or better or worse, but you know that you have a partner that's going to be there for you. We're going to deal with deployment. You know, so many military people listen to our broadcast. And so how do you deal when your spouse is always deployed and you don't even feel like you really have a marriage, but a couple of months after the year, if that many months that you're able to spend with your spouse, how do you remain married when you are without them physically on the home front? You're without them more than you are with them. We're going to deal with what it really means to sacrifice in marriage for your marriage. A lot of people would say, hey, I sacrifice every day and I go to work and I do this and I do that. But when you ask their spouse, they feel like they don't sacrifice enough for the marriage. We're going to deal with when divorce becomes an option. How do you know if it's time to call it quits? I'm going to be interviewing several people who've gone through divorce, some who've remarried and have great second marriages that outlasted their first marriage. Some divorced, you know, 5 or 6 years in on their first marriage, but now they're in their second marriage. And they've been married 20, 30 years. They have children with these people, and they have a thriving second marriage. We're going to really deal with the serious issues, the things that we're not saying in church, that we're not telling our friends, that we're just hiding from. We're going to confront those issues. We're going to confront the empty nesters. They are the growing population at this current time of the highest rate of divorce. We're going to unpack what is going on in marriages that are 20 and 30 years in, and as soon as they become empty nesters, they're calling it quits. We're going to deal with pride in marriage. You know, we're going to really address when people really have a problem or have a struggle with the spirit of pride in their marriage. We're going to deal with toxicity in marriage, and each marriage can be toxic in different ways, and we're going to deal with just various areas of why the marriage is toxic. We're going to deal with self-worth, self-esteem in marriage. We're going to deal with criticism in marriage. We also are going to deal with what it really takes to change in marriage, because you can't change your spouse, but you can change yourself. But it does take two to make it work. I know we love that whole theory of, well, long as one of y'all are working on the marriage, that's just a myth. It has to be both of you all working on it for there to be a marriage. Yes, you can do the work on yourself, but for the marriage to work, there has to be two people. Look at your marriage license. That took two signatures. You didn't go to that altar and vow to yourself. You vow to that person, and you vow unto God. So again, it is great that, yeah, we're going to work on ourselves, but at some point, that other spouse is going to have to do the work with you for that marriage to thrive. We're going to deal with, you know, something that we've all said before. I didn't sign up for this. When your expectations are not met in marriage, we're going to deal with the issue when grace is absent, when you feel like your spouse is not accepting of you. You feel like your spouse is not wanting to give you grace and forgiveness. We're going to deal with unforgiveness in marriage. We're going to deal with the competing spouse, that spouse that always feel like they have to win. They always want to argue. They always want to make sure they're coming out on top. And we're going to really deal with that spouse to let them know and to really give them an understanding that if you're the only one winning, then we are both losing. We're going to deal with growing weary and well doing in marriage. It's 5, 6, 7, 10 years in, and you're still dealing with the same issue. You've given grace, you've forgiven, and they keep going back and doing the same thing, and there's been no change. There's been no true repentance. And I always say a lot of people want forgiveness without true repentance. We're going to deal with what do you do when you have just truly grown, you've just really weary and well doing. It's no other way to say it. When you have just come to a place of just feeling worn out with your spouse. We're going to deal with the things that are internal weapons in marriage versus external. A lot of times we like to blame everything on the enemy and say, well, the devil's just fighting my marriage. But sometimes your spouse has chosen to be used by the enemy to make your marriage more difficult than it has to be. And I always say it's like an implosion. You know, when a building is coming down, there's two different ways. They're either going to take a wrecking ball, which is external, and they're going to bring the building down. But when they put dynamite on the inside of the building and bring it down that way, it's called an implosion. And there are some spouses that you literally are causing an implosion in your marriage. You're bringing it down from the inside. We're going to deal with the frustrated spouse. And frustration can be just a laundry list of different things, but we're going to deal with the true day-to-day frustrations, that mundane. We're going to deal with the adversities and hardships that come along in marriage. We're going to deal with the sex issues in marriage, impotence. We're going to deal when people don't have a sex drive or just don't feel the need to want to have sex, so they therefore are keeping themselves away from their spouses. We're going to deal with disagreements and arguments that keep coming up in marriages. We're going to deal with that spouse who does not really leave and cleave from their family and really make you a priority. Some of you going through that, where you feel like your spouse still makes their family the priority and not you. We're going to deal with unmet needs and expectations. We're going to deal with how to have the fruit of the Spirit in your marriage and how to walk in the fruit of the Spirit in your marriage on a daily basis. We're going to deal with how to rebuild when trust has been broken. We're going to deal with ministry in marriage, how, you know, if you're a Christian couple and you're over some type of ministry, or maybe you're a pastor and a pastor's wife, how do you deal with your issues while still leading the people of God? You know, we're going to deal with the lack of appreciation. You know, a lot of times, a lot of spouses feel unappreciated in marriage. We're going to deal with that. You will be shocked at just how many things can cause a vow to break in marriage. Defensiveness, the tit-for-tat trap that we find ourselves when a spouse no longer has passion or romance, you know, where you feel like you're just being taken for granted. We're going to deal with how do you weather the storm when it gets worse before it gets better. We're going to deal with what healing really looks like in marriage. We're going to deal with how to truly spend quality time and enjoy one another again in order so that the vow does not break. We're going to deal with regret and resentment and bitterness that goes on in marriage. We're going to deal with the pain and the woundedness of marriage. And so many times the person that can hurt you the most is the person that you lay beside every night. No one can push your buttons like your spouse and turn you on or turn you off. You know, your spouse has the ability in marriage to be either your greatest headache or your greatest joy. And we know that the vow is breaking because they're choosing to be a headache and not a joy. You know, they can sometimes be, you know, sometimes wives particularly can feel like it's just such a laundry list of just duties that you're just doing, you know, to make that spouse happy. But you wonder, when will they ever make my happiness a priority? We're going to deal with those things. These are real things. We're going to deal with when there's hatred in your heart towards your spouse and how to get healed, set free, and delivered. We're going to deal with how to have a true support system around you and what that looks like so that your vow doesn't break. We're going to deal with disappointment. We're going to deal with offense in marriage. We're going to deal with busyness and the lack of rest that most marriages don't have. You're just overloaded. Your schedules are just out of control. We're going to deal with the triggers and the traumas and the pressures that come along in marriage. It's just so many things that we're going to deal with. I mean, we can list just hundreds of things in different, like I said, interviews and different things and topics that we're going to bring up. But my main heart is to really get us to a place in harmony with one another and in unity with one another, the way we were the day we made the vow. But now we find ourselves in a place of you feel your vow breaking. And you know, the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 5:5 that it's better not to make a vow than to make one and break it. But what happens when your heart is broken in your marriage and you feel like that your spouse is breaking the vow that they made to you? And not just the vows of that day of the wedding, but other promises that they've made. You know, when you feel like your covenant is being torn apart. And I have to be honest, so many people right now are, you know, separating and divorcing, and some for definitely biblical reasons. And many of you, I believe this new ministry, this series will be a healing agent, and it will cause you to be able to reconcile with your spouse. But again, I want to be honest that some people will go through this process with us through this ministry and this series, and some of you will come to the conclusion that you really have exhausted all possibilities, given grace upon grace, mercy upon mercy. You've gone to counseling and you're into years of this spouse just being a habitual, unrepentant person. And you know, for you, the best choice will be to exit that marriage. You know, we want to bring divorce recovery healing for you. So again, this ministry, this series will help all, you know, those who are doing good in marriage, but you know you need to, you know, have that maintenance. Some of these things are things that you've gone through before, or you all have that. We do good for a year, then we go into that cycle and we get on the crazy train. This is for you. If you're in the worst place you've ever been in the state of your marriage, this ministry and series is for you. If you are currently right now considering separation, divorce, this ministry and this series is for you. If you right now are on your second marriage and you realize you don't want to repeat those same mistakes or have those same issues come up, this ministry and this series is for you. And if you're someone who's now divorced and you're considering remarriage, this series for you. If you are trying to figure out how you're going to blend, you know, your families together because both of you have been divorced, both of you know what it's like when the vow breaks, this ministry and this series is for you. The best advice, you know, that I got when I got married was from a couple that had been married 55 years and at the time when I got married, and they said, you know, we just give it one day at a time, because we're like, how do you stay with someone for 55 years? And they said, just one day at a time. And then I went home and I prayed about it, and I said, not only do you have to take it one day at a time, you got to take it a day at a time, then give it one more day. And that's the conclusion that I hope you have at the end of this series, throughout this ministry, is taking it a day at a time, you know, having that approach and then giving it one more day. There's been so many times, even in my own marriage, that we've taken a day at a time and then we'll give it just one more day, you know, and sometimes that good night's rest will give you a different perspective that next morning when you've had a hard, tough day, season, road, journey, or years with a spouse. And we're going to deal with all that. But that's my prayer, and that is definitely my hope, that this will ignite and rekindle and reconnect and reconcile so many marriages that seem broken, that seem like they're just in the throes of just life and tragedies and just different things happening that they just couldn't even fathom that they would go through with their spouse. But I want you to see that you can come out on the other side better, beyond, and have even a greater marriage than you even imagine, no matter where you find yourself, you know. And that is my prayer. That is going to be my heart throughout this series. But like I said, I do realize that for some people, it'll be a divorce support for you. It'll be a support to help you pull the pieces that broke, those broken pieces of those vows, to pull those pieces back together so that you are whole again. So we want you to know that this ministry and this series is for everyone, no matter where you find yourself on the scale of divorce, remarriage, separation, good marriage, just need to have maintenance and make sure you're getting your tune-ups and checking everything out, or you're in the worst state that you've ever been in your marriage. But again, we're going to be here as a community together to help each marriage to take it one day at a time and then give it one more day. And hopefully your marriage will have that one more day, that one more chance for you all to be able to have the love story that I know God has created for you and the love story that you so desire. But no matter where you find yourself, there is always hope in God for what he's called for you to do and what he's already predestined and who he's predestined for you to be. And we're here to support you no matter the need.